नमस्कार दोस्तों, आपका इस वीडियो लेक्चर सीरीज मैकेनिक्स में स्वागत है। इसमें हम आज फ्रिक्शन के बारे में पढ़ेंगे। सबसे इम्पोर्टेंट टाइप ऑफ फोर्स है। बाकी फोर्सेस के बारे में जानने के लिए मेरे पिछले वीडियो लेक्चर को देखिए, जिसमें टाइप्स ऑफ फोर्सेस समझाई गई है। और मैकेनिक्स में जब आप लॉज ऑफ मोशन के न्यूमेरिकल सॉल्व करेंगे, तो सबसे पहले आपको फ्रिक्शन के बारे में सबसे ज़्यादा मालूम होना चाहिए। सो टुडे वी विल स्टडी फ्रिक्शन एंड हाउ फ्रिक्शन इम्पैक्ट्स अवर लाइफ। एंड दिस इज़ टू गिव यू अ ब्रॉड पिक्चर ऑफ फ्रिक्शन। दिस इज़ नॉट अ मैथमेटिक्स ओरिएंटेड क्लास, दिस इज़ मोर ऑफ कॉन्सेप्चुअल क्लास। तो हमारा इंडेवर इस क्लास में रहेगा कि हम कॉन्सेप्ट पे ध्यान दें, ना कि हम उसके सीधा न्यूमेरिकल नहीं करेंगे। पहले हम समझेंगे कि फ्रिक्शन होता क्या है और वो कैसे हमारी लाइफ में आता है। और देखिए, आप पहले स्क्रीन को देखेंगे तो आपको सबसे पहले जो स्लाइड नज़र आएगी, ये देखिए, ये स्लाइड है। तो पहला क्वेश्चन जो आपको आता है वो आता है, व्हाट इज़ फ्रिक्शन, होता क्या है फ्रिक्शन। तो बेसिकली आप देखिए, कोई भी सरफेस अगर आप पे कोई ऑब्जेक्ट रखेंगे और वो ऑब्जेक्ट जो है उसको आप फोर्स अप्लाई करेंगे उसके ऊपर, और वो ऑब्जेक्ट एक दूसरे सरफेस के ऊपर बैठा हुआ है। देखिए यहाँ पे ये ऑब्जेक्ट है, और जो नीचे अगर आप देखेंगे इसके, तो ये एक सरफेस है। और जो किताब है जो आप दिख रही है आपको, जिसको ऑब्जेक्ट हम बोल रहे हैं, यहाँ पे भी एक सरफेस है। और हम एक यहाँ पे अप्लाइड फोर्स लगा रहे हैं। देखिए, हम किताब को अपनी तरफ खींच रहे हैं। तो देखिए, जब आप किताब को अपनी तरफ खींचेंगे, तो ये जो दो सरफेस हैं, एक किताब का सरफेस और दूसरा टेबल का सरफेस, इन दोनों के बीच में एक ऑपोजिशनल फोर्स आती है, उसको फ्रिक्शनल फोर्स बोलते हैं। यहाँ पे देखिए, ये फ्रिक्शनल फोर्स है। तो अगर आप कोई भी सरफेस लेंगे और उसके ऊपर एक ऑब्जेक्ट रखेंगे, ये आपका सरफेस है, और इस ऑब्जेक्ट को आप इधर खींचेंगे, तो यहाँ पे आपको फ्रिक्शन महसूस होगा, और ये आपकी अप्लाइड फोर्स है। तो ये स्लाइडिंग वर्ड जो अगर आप देख रहे हैं यहाँ पे, स्लाइडिंग, इस पे बहुत एम्फसाइज करते हैं, क्योंकि जब भी आप स्लाइड करते हैं तो जो फ्रिक्शन आता है उसको स्लाइडिंग फ्रिक्शन बोलते हैं। मल्टीपल टाइप्स ऑफ फ्रिक्शन होते हैं। सबसे पहले हम सिर्फ डेफिनेशन जान लेते हैं। ये ब्रॉड डेफिनेशन हर टाइप के फ्रिक्शन के ऊपर होती है, और ये एक टेंडेंसी होती है, एक ऐसी फोर्स होती है ये, जो अप्लाइड फोर्स को अपोज करती है। अगर आप इसको राइट साइड पे खींचेंगे तो फ्रिक्शन लेफ्ट साइड पे आएगा, उसी तरह अगर आप इसको लेफ्ट साइड पे खींचेंगे ऑब्जेक्ट को, तो यहाँ जो फ्रिक्शन आएगा वो इस डायरेक्शन में आएगा। तो इट इज़ एन ऑपोजिशनल फोर्स, जो भी आप करेंगे उसका उल्टा करेगी ये। तो उम्मीद करता हूँ आपको ये बेसिक जो कॉन्सेप्ट है रिलेटिव स्लाइडिंग मोशन का, तो रिलेटिव मोशन बहुत ज़रूरी है कि एक सरफेस और दूसरा सरफेस उसके ऊपर, ये दोनों एक दूसरे के टच में हो और इनके बीच में रिलेटिव मोशन हो, माने एक सरफेस दूसरे सरफेस के ऊपर स्लाइड कर रहा हो। आइए इसको जान लेते हैं, होता क्यों है। तो देखिए, ये फ्रिक्शन जो है वो होता इसलिए कि दो जो सरफेसेस होती हैं, जो एक दूसरे के टच में होती हैं, वो सरफेसेस बेसिकली माइक्रोस्कोपिक लेवल पे अगर आप देखेंगे तो वैलीज और माउंटेन्स की बनी होती हैं। देखिए, ये वैलीज और माउंटेन्स का डायग्राम है। देखिए, ये आपकी एक वैली है और ये आपके बेसिकली, देखिए, ये माउंटेन्स हैं। तो दो सरफेसेस हैं, और माइक्रोस्कोपिक लेवल के ऊपर अगर देखेंगे तो वो सरफेसेस ऊपर से आपको स्मूथ नजर आएंगे। मान लीजिए शीशा है, वो आपको स्मूथ नजर आएगा। सो इफ यू हैव टू सरफेसेस विच आर टचिंग ईच अदर एंड दे हैव रिलेटिव मोशन बिटवीन देम, दीज वैलीज एंड माउंटेन्स इंटरलॉक। तो ये वैलीज और माउंटेन्स एक दूसरे के अंदर फंस जाती हैं, और इसलिए आप फ्रिक्शन को महसूस करते हैं। तो इनका क्या काम होगा? इनका काम होगा जो भी मोशन आप इनको देंगे उसको अपोज करने का होगा। तो ये बेसिकली जो आपका मटेरियल है वो एक दूसरे के रास्ते में आ रहा है। सो द मटेरियल, द टू सर्फेसिस, द सर्फेस नंबर वन, मान लीजिए दिस इज सर्फेस नंबर वन एंड दिस इज सर्फेस नंबर टू। सो द माउंटेन्स ऑफ सर्फेस नंबर वन आर गेटिंग स्ट्रक इन वैलीज ऑफ माउंट द सर्फेस नंबर टू एंड वाइस वर्सा। सो ईच सर्फेस कम्स इन द वे ऑफ मूवमेंट ऑफ द अदर सर्फेस. तो एक सर्फेस दूसरे सर्फेस के मोशन के रास्ते में आता है, अड़चन डालता है. वो अड़चन आपको फ्रिक्शन के तौर पे महसूस होती है. और ये तब कब आती है? जब आप एक सर्फेस को दूसरे सर्फेस के ऊपर खिसकाने की कोशिश करेंगे, माने स्लाइड करने की कोशिश करेंगे. देर आर फाइव लॉज ऑफ फ्रिक्शन. सो इफ़ यू आर बिल्डिंग अ कॉन्सेप्ट, तो हमें सिचुएशन को विजुलाइज करने आना चाहिए. तो वी मस्ट अंडरस्टैंड कि पांच लॉ ऑफ फ्रिक्शन हैं क्या. तो देखिए, फर्स्ट लॉ ये बोलता है कि जो फ्रिक्शन पैदा होता है, इट इज़ डायरेक्टली प्रोपोर्शनल टू द नॉर्मल रिएक्शन, नॉर्मल फोर्स. नॉर्मल फोर्स भी एक टाइप ऑफ फोर्स होती है, अगर आप पिछले वीडियो लेक्चर को देखेंगे. और जो आपका फ्रिक्शनल फोर्स है, उसकी डायरेक्शन परपेंडिकुलर टू नॉर्मल फोर्स होती है. मान लीजिए आपका ये एक ऑब्जेक्ट है और इसकी ये नॉर्मल रिएक्शन है, और आप इसे इधर इस तरफ खींचते हैं, तो फ्रिक्शनल फोर्स यहाँ पे पैदा होगा, फ्रिक्शनल फोर्स. तो ये आपका एक अप्लाइड फोर्स है, देखिए ये अप्लाइड फोर्स है और ये नॉर्मल रिएक्शन है. तो ये जो आपका फ्रिक्शनल फोर्स है, एफ एफ अगर मैं बोलूँ, इट इज़ प्रोपोर्शनल टू नॉर्मल रिएक्शन. जो भी नॉर्मल रिएक्शन होगा, सॉरी, ऊपर की तरफ होगा नॉर्मल रिएक्शन, फ्रिक्शनल फोर्स उसके प्रोपोर्शनल होगी. दूसरा, फ्रिक्शनल फोर्स एरिया ऑफ कॉन्टैक्ट के ऊपर डिपेंडेंट नहीं होता. मान लीजिए अगर आप एक बड़ा एरिया रख लें या आप छोटा एरिया रख लें, द फ्रिक्शन फोर्स डज नॉट डिपेंड ऑन एरिया. देखिए यहाँ पे एरिया है, ये एरिया इसका मान लीजिए ए वन है और इसका ए टू है. ए वन इज़ ग्रेटर देन ए टू. तो अगर ये किसी अलग सरफेस के कॉन्टैक्ट में होंगे तो भी ये कोई इस पर फ़र्क पड़ेगा नहीं, बेसिकली ये कहना चाह रहे हैं ये. तो ये जो आपका दूसरा लॉ है कि फोर्स ऑफ फ्रिक्शन, जो दो सर्फेसेज आपस में टच होती हैं उनके आपस में जो एरिया ऑफ कॉन्टैक्ट होता है उस पर डिपेंडेंट नहीं है. तीसरा, जो कोफिशेंट ऑफ स्टैटिक फ्रिक्शन है वो हमेशा काइनेटिक से बड़ा होता है. देखिए जब एक बॉडी, हम बताएंगे, मैं आपको आगे बताऊंगा कि कोफिशेंट ऑफ स्टैटिक फ्रिक्शन क्या होता है. वर्ड से ही आपको मालूम चल जाएगा कि स्टैटिक फ्रिक्शन का मतलब है रुका हुआ. स्टैटिक मीन्स व्हेन द टू सर्फेसेस आर एट रेस्ट एंड वन सर्फेस और द ऑब्जेक्ट ऑन द सर्फेस इज नॉट एबल टू मूव बिकॉज ऑफ द फ्रिक्शन. तो एक ऑब्जेक्ट हिल ही नहीं पा रहा है क्योंकि इतना ज़्यादा फ्रिक्शन है, तो उसको स्टैटिक फ्रिक्शन बोलते हैं. लेकिन एक बार आप उसको ज़्यादा दम लगा के हिला देंगे तो वो काइनेटिक या मोशन में आ जाएगा, तो उसको काइनेटिक फ्रिक्शन बोलते हैं. और स्टैटिक फ्रिक्शन जो रुकी हुई बॉडी पे लगता है वो हमेशा चलती हुई बॉडी से ज़्यादा होता है. तो द कोफिशेंट ऑफ स्टैटिक फ्रिक्शन इज स्लाइटली हायर, थोड़ा सा फ़र्क होता है, देन द कोफिशेंट ऑफ काइनेटिक फ्रिक्शन. चौथा लॉ जो है, काइनेटिक फ्रिक्शन इज़ इंडिपेंडेंट ऑफ वेलोसिटी ऑफ द बॉडी. सो द काइनेटिक फ्रिक्शन, सो व्हेन द बॉडी इज़ इन मोशन. तो काइनेटिक फ्रिक्शन कब आता है? व्हेन द बॉडी इज़ इन मोशन, व्हेन the relative motion has commenced. और पांचवा जो लॉ है वो है कि फ्रिक्शन डिपेंड्स ऑन टाइप ऑफ सर्फेसेस इन कॉन्टैक्ट. तो मान लीजिए अगर आपके पास एक बहुत ही स्मूथ मार्बल है और उसके ऊपर आपने कारपेट बिछा रखा है जो बिल्कुल ही रगेड है, जो बहुत ही रफ है, और नीचे मार्बल है, तो यहाँ पे जो फ्रिक्शन होगा अलग होगा. अब यही मार्बल लेके आप इसके ऊपर एक कॉटन की चद्दर बिछा दीजिए तो फ्रिक्शन फोर्स कम हो जाएगा, आपका कम हो जाएगा, इधर काफ़ी ज़्यादा फ्रिक्शन फोर्स होगा. और फ्रिक्शनल जो काइनेटिक फ्रिक्शन है, जो फ्रिक्शन जो अराइज होता है मोशन की वजह से, वो वेलोसिटी पे डिपेंडेंट नहीं होता. फ्रिक्शनल फोर्स इज नॉट डिपेंडेंट ऑन वेलोसिटी. So I'll just repeat in English the five laws of friction. The first law says that frictional force is directly proportional to normal reaction, and the frictional force is always perpendicular to the normal force. So if you look into this diagram, this is your normal reaction, this is your frictional force, this is your applied force. You can see that the normal is in this direction, y direction, and frictional force is in x direction. And the magnitude of frictional force is directly proportional to normal reaction. This should be known to you because we will use this as part of our mathematics. And then the coefficient of static friction सेकेंड लॉ विच यू मस्ट नो इज दैट फ्रिक्शन डज नॉट डिपेंड ऑन एरिया ऑफ कॉन्टैक्ट. सो इट इज इंडिपेंडेंट. सो वॉट एवर एरियाज आर इन कॉन्टैक्ट विद ईच अदर, द रफ सर्फिसेज, देयर एरियाज डजेंट मैटर. सो इट इज नॉट डिपेंडेंट ऑन एरिया. ओके, एंड लेट्स लुक इन टू दिस काइनेटिक फ्रिक्शन. सो द कोफिशंट ऑफ स्टैटिक फ्रिक्शन इज स्लाइटली हायर than the coefficient of kinetic friction. We will study what it means. Then kinetic friction is independent of velocity of the body. You must know this law, that if a body is in motion, if a body is at 20 kilometers per hour on a road or 30 kilometers per hour, the friction is independent of speed. Friction does not depend how fast is your car moving. It is independent of that. The third law is difficult to explain now, because we will study what is coefficient of static friction and what is coefficient of kinetic friction. Coefficient of static friction is when the body is in touch with the surface and is unable to move because of the friction. The friction is so high that the body is not able to move. So that is called as coefficient of static friction. We will study the mathematics. And then you have the coefficient of kinetic friction, which is by virtue of the motion. Then friction depends on the type of surface in contact. Friction will depend on the two surfaces which are in touch with each other. The two surfaces which are in touch with each other, for example, glass and one more body. You know, you can pick up any two surfaces. The coefficient of friction depends on type of surfaces you have chosen. If you have chosen ice and some other rough surface, the coefficient of friction between them is different. If you've chosen ice and some other surface, maybe a carpet, the coefficient of friction is different. So you must understand these five laws of friction and how they operate and how they impact you. So while you solve your numericals, be very careful that you understand these five laws. Okay, now let me just demonstrate. We talked about the coefficient of static friction and kinetic friction to understand this. So if you look into your, on your left hand side, there is a boy who is applying a force of 34 newtons on the block, and there is a friction. And if you can see, the word acceleration is mentioned here, which means the body has started moving. So when bodies start moving because of external force, you have beaten friction, and therefore, you are able to move, because the applied force is greater than the frictional force, and the net force is your applied force minus frictional force. And this net force, if you divide by mass, you get acceleration. So if you see this diagram, what you see is that the boy is applying a force of 34 newtons and there is a frictional force of 18 newtons, which means the net force on this block, which is causing its acceleration, is around 16 newtons. Now this friction, which is because of motion, because the body has started moving, is called as kinetic friction, and it is also known as sliding friction. But on the right hand side, if you see, the boy is putting effort but is not able to move the object. Such a situation is for a situation which is static friction. This is static friction situation. So you must visualize the situations to solve physics problems. So this is your static friction. This is your kinetic friction. Right? I hope it is clear to you, because we studied on this slide what is kinetic friction. And so these words were not familiar to you. If you're not familiar with kinetic friction, now you know what is kinetic friction. And what is static friction? We will try to understand this again and understand what is coefficient. This word is probably not known to you. So let's try to understand the coefficients now. After understanding the kinetic and static friction, static friction is also known as self-adjusting friction. Okay. So if the boy is pushing, this friction will adjust. This is self-adjusting friction. Okay. Now let's talk about the static friction. See, this friction is something which keeps everything at rest. Otherwise, everything will start sliding. तो ये static friction वो ताकत है या force है जो सबको रोक के रखती है. अगर आपने अपना phone table के ऊपर रखा है, वो फिसल नहीं रहा है, वो रुका हुआ है. So if you've kept any object on another object and the object is not sliding, which means it there is, you know, it is not being subjected to kinetic friction, the friction is called as static friction. So this is your static friction, and if you look into this, it is proportional to the normal reaction. So the ratio of the static friction and the normal reaction is called as the coefficient of static friction. This is what is coefficient of static friction. So you can look into this diagram. This is your external force. This is your the static friction, and this is your weight. This is applied by gravity. We know this is a long range force. Long range force, and this is your normal reaction. This is your normal reaction. So this is basically when the bodies are at rest. So you must understand that the bodies are currently at rest. So ye apply tab hota hai jab ye rest mein hote hain. Ye one body is in rest. Nothing is moving. So it's very important to understand the meaning of the word static. Now let's move to the next type of friction, which is your kinetic friction. So kinetic friction is when the, you know, if you're able to overcome the static friction, the force of kinetic friction is what slows down the moving object. So if you're applying a force F, you have kinetic friction opposing it, then the body doesn't move with infinite acceleration, but there is some friction that exists. So body is in motion, okay, and the body is in motion, but friction still exists. Now this friction is called kinetic friction. So I hope this is clear to you. Kinetic friction and static friction are very important. If you in your numerical you see something moving, this is likely the case of kinetic friction. And just to give you a practical visualization of friction, if you see steel on steel, if you have a steel body and you keep another steel body on them, the static friction is 0.74. And so first of all, there are two surfaces involved, remember that, two surfaces. So it's steel on steel, glass on glass, metal on metal, ice on ice. So if you look, ice on ice is the lowest probably, and then is Teflon. In fact, Teflon is the lowest. If you see, the static friction is so low, it's even lower than the ice. So this is a tire on snow, right? Tire on snow, you can see. Tire on wet road. So if you know, if you have a tire on snow, your car is likely to slide. Your car is going to slide. So you must understand this part, that this chart represents static friction versus kinetic friction for two surfaces, and you can start studying that, you know, which frictions are very low, which frictions are very, and you can see generally mu static is greater than mu kinetic. And if you look into this tire on concrete, and this is a very practical example, you see this, right? You see this tire on concrete, this is the highest friction you have. And look into glass on glass. Look at, you know, glass appears to be very smooth, but look at the static friction. It doesn't move very easily. But once it starts moving, look into the friction. So your friction initially is always static, and then you start applying an external force, and you take it to a certain point. After that, the kinetic friction comes, and kinetic friction is always less than the static friction. So this diagram explains you that. this diagram explains that if you apply a force and you keep on increasing like this, the static friction also goes up and it reaches a top point. So it has reached this point, and then if you see, this starts going down and then it becomes stable. So here it has become stable. So this is your kinetic region when you, because now you're in motion and now you are here in static situation. Now look into your right hand side, same diagram but explained in a very different manner. The only difference is here the movement from static to kinetic is gradual. Here it is abrupt. That's all. You know, it is shown to be a straight line. And so this is smooth sliding. Okay, and this is your static part. So I hope they can ask you how to draw a diagram and explain the difference between the static and kinetic friction. So you can see the kinetic friction is less compared to the static friction. Static friction is a self-adjusting friction. It keeps on increasing and it reaches its highest point called as FS max. So this is your highest point for the static friction. Now look into this diagram, the same diagram being explained in more detailed manner where you have drawn some figures and you can see the static friction and the threshold. It reaches at the highest peak point, then it drops and now your motion has started. This is kinetic and you can see the kinetic friction coefficient is just 0.4 and the static friction coefficient is 0.5. So they can ask you, maybe to ask you to read the graph and based on that they give you some numerical. Now look into this some practical aspects to understand and visualize the situation. This is an inclined plane and on an inclined plane you have a weight whose weight is this. There are two components of the weight. One is the one which is trying to bring it down, the other one which is exerting a force on the surface of the inclined plane, and then there is a normal reaction you can see. So if you see this, if the weight is trying to pull it down, this is your the force which is the resistive force, and this resistive force is upwards, right? It opposes the applied force. So you can see this body is right now not moving down, it is stationary. But if you start increasing this angle, maybe you increase the angle, this may start, this may go down. So till the time it doesn't go down, it is static friction. Body is at rest. And if it starts going down, it is, in motion, and then it's kinetic friction, right? So this is one of the most popular questions of inclined plane and the frictional force. If you look into your right-hand side, again, it shows one thing. The two surfaces are in touch with each other here. There is a weight and there is an opposing frictional force, which is upwards, and this is your normal reaction. So if your weight is trying to pull you down, the frictional force will take you up. You see, this is the frictional force. So the frictional force is taking you up here. So that is what will prevent the body to go down. So if you have enough, it depends on how much normal reaction you're able to generate. So you're pressing the body against the surface. This pressing is generating a normal reaction. So this is another very important popular kind of numerical they can ask you. When a body is being pushed against a wall, why is it not going down? They can ask you this. Now let's understand some application of friction. So, if you look into European and American countries, you will find sand is often placed on icy road because the road is very slippery and you want to decrease the you want to increase the friction rather, right? So your endeavor is to increase the coefficient of friction between the tires. And so if you look into these choices, there are four choices. So why would you put so first option is decreases the coefficient of friction between the tires of a car and the road. So will you put sand to reduce friction or increase friction? This doesn't appear to be correct because it says you will further decrease. This way your tire will start sliding. Then it says increase the coefficient of friction between the tires of the road and sorry, tires of the car and road? Answer is yes, this can be right, because you want to increase the friction between the tires and the road so that you can prevent the slipping of car. Then decreasing the gravitational force on the car. Earth only can change the gravitational force, nothing else. Normal force is something which comes from the earth, you know, as a reaction to the weight. So this is out of your control. So this appears to be the right answer. Right? Now look into this. Practical application. In you know, you have Poland where there is a lake where people are able to do ice, you know, skiing, because the boat is able to slide. So you can have fun if the friction is very low. So this is an example where people are having fun because the frictional force between the two surfaces, the boat and the ice, is very low. So you can imagine what type of surface they will choose. Maybe Teflon, because it has a very low coefficient of friction with ice. So you can go back to the charts and see what is the coefficient of friction of Teflon, what is the coefficient of friction of ice, and you know, maybe that's a good answer. And look into how friction sometimes, instead of preventing you from moving, you know, can help you also move on the ground. The movement is because you are pushing the ground, you know, using your feet. So while you walk, you're pushing it backwards, and if you push backwards, the friction pushes you forward, right? So we are able to walk because of friction. So you cannot walk without friction. If there is no friction, you know, you will not be able to move forward. So this is the importance of friction. You must be able to visualize the situations where the friction is supporting you, you know, to move. Friction supports motion. The second is when friction prevents motion. So both situations are possible when you're trying to solve a numerical. So let me just go back to the laws of numerical once more for your benefit. These are the five laws of friction. Okay, so let's recall. When a body is moving, the friction is directly proportional to normal force, and frictional force is directly perpendicular to the normal force. So you must know how to calculate the frictional force. So for calculation, you use this formula. You see, are you able to see this formula? This is to calculate. It is directly proportional to the normal reaction, and the ratio is of the frictional force and normal reaction is called as coefficient of friction. And so this is your first law, and the direction obviously is known to you now. So if there is a body, the direction and normal reaction is here. The frictional force will be here or here. The angle between normal reaction and frictional force is always 90 degrees. The second law is the friction force does not depend on area of contact. So it doesn't matter, you know, what area, whether your tire is big or small. The area of tire does not matter because that decides your area of contact. Frictional force is independent of area of contact of the two surfaces. The third is coefficient of friction is higher than the value, higher value than the coefficient of kinetic friction. So if you're stationary, you know, you may be experiencing more friction, although it's not visible. You may be experiencing more friction compared to the kinetic friction. So therefore, the coefficient of static friction is larger than the coefficient of kinetic friction. Fourth, kinetic friction is independent of the velocity of the body. So if you have started moving, you will still face some friction, but that kinetic friction will not be dependent on how fast are you moving. It is independent. So kinetic friction is independent of velocity. And then you have friction depending on the types of surfaces, which are in touch. So just to explain you the fifth point, you know, this is the fifth point. So these are the type of surfaces. So you can see the coefficient of friction is different. If coefficient of friction is different for each surface, each of the two surfaces, then the friction is also different. So I hope the laws of friction are clear to you. the basic concept, the at the microscopic level, why we experience friction because of mountains and valleys, and then the calculation, it's a very small part of it. It's directly proportional to normal reaction, and mu is the coefficient of static friction or the kinetic friction. And then you have to study, depending on surface, how much friction is there. Then this is a detailed diagram that explains that static friction is going up, and then gradually it reaches the peak point, then it drops, and it becomes stationary, right? So this is your static and kinetic friction. And these are the two popular numericals you see: inclined plane and a body is being pushed against the surface, and why they are stationary, because the static friction is still there and it prevents the weight to go down inclined as well as in this situation. And if you look into this situation, it says sand is often placed on any icy road because, so this conceptual question helps you understand how friction helps you in daily life. So countries where there is a lot of snow, they use sand to increase the friction so that cars don't slide. And look into this diagram. This is your ice, and then you have some people enjoying. So low friction can sometimes become fun. And look into this situation where you're able to walk because of friction. So sometimes friction can support your motion. So I hope the basic concept of friction is clear to you. This was not an endeavor to go in a large detail and create some big equation and solve some numerical, unless you understand what is the basic of friction, how it operates in different situations. It's very difficult to solve the problem. So just listen to this video lecture once more and try and grasp as much as you can. So if you like my lecture, give me a thumbs up, subscribe to my channel, and I look forward to meet you again. Have a great day, and thank you very much for your time. तो मैं उम्मीद करता हूँ आपको फ्रिक्शन के बारे में कुछ समझ में आया होगा, और आप इसके बारे में और भी पढ़ सकते हैं दूसरी किताबों से और नेट पे, और आप देखेंगे कि आपको बेसिक लॉ जो है पांच फ्रिक्शन के, वो समझ आने चाहिए. और आप इसकी विजुलाइजेशन के लिए इस वीडियो लेक्चर को ध्यान से सुने. उम्मीद करता हूँ आपको ये वीडियो लेक्चर पसंद आया होगा. अगर पसंद आया तो इसे लाइक करिए और चैनल को सब्सक्राइब करिए. अपना कीमती समय देने के लिए बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद. आपका दिन शुभ हो.